heard a African-American preacher say one time, he said, if Christians would catch on fire, the world would gather around just to watch them burn. Now, the irony of that is that in the early days of the church, crowds did gather around to watch them burn as they burned them to the stake. We haven't faced that yet in our culture, but we are called to shine and to be consumed for Him. Turn in your Bibles, please, to 1 Corinthians as we've just begun our study of this perfect gospel, which is good and effectual for imperfect churches. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, please. Verses 10 to 17 is what we're looking at today. As we think about this, that Paul begins immediately that these divisions undermine the gospel. Let's stand together, if you would. Follow along with your own copy of the scriptures. If you don't have one, we've got them printed on the screens for you. I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree, that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same judgment. For it's been reported to me by Chloe's people that there's quarreling among you, my brothers. What I mean is that each one of you says, I follow Paul, or I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas, or I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one may say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. This is what it's the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient word of God. Paul has just opened up this letter, blessing these people, I thank God for you. And now he's getting into the issues that prompted the writing of this letter. The first of the issues being a divisive spirit in the congregation at Corinth. May the Lord teach us from this that we not be found that way. Thank you. Please be seated. Church at Corinth. At a temple of great proportions and 1,000 temple prostitutes. And a very cosmopolitan city. With a fairly new church. I told you last week this letter was probably written around 56 AD. The church has not been around that many years. And they've gotten caught up in something here. You hear it by different terms. Preacher worship, party spirit. And word's gotten back to Paul that that's happening. But rather than them rejoice that they had the ministry of Paul, and had the ministry of Apollos, and had the ministry of Peter, that's who Cephas is, that's become an occasion for them to line up behind their favorite preacher. And in doing so, undermine the unity in that congregation and indeed undermine the very nature of the gospel. Let's look at what Paul has to say here. I think you can unpack these verses along three ways of thinking. First of all, that if we're going to avoid this, if we're going to be a people who promote unity and check the tendency to division, that there must be a commitment to striving after harmony with other Christians. Second, there must be a commitment to Jesus Christ above all other allegiances. And third, there must be a commitment to the proclamation of the gospel. Let's look at this together. This need, as one writer says, Paul in these few verses gives a definition, a working definition of Christian commitment. This need that there must be a commitment to striving after harmony with other Christians. Look at verse 10 again. I appeal to you, brother. So this, it's not initially a scolding. He's going to get to scolding them when he gets farther down in his writing this letter. But first it's an appeal. I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, this is not something that you ought to hear and say, well, Paul would like for us. No, Paul says, my appeal is in the name of Jesus, your Lord, your Savior, as we sang, your Savior King, that all of you agree, that there be no divisions among you, that you be united in the same mind and the same judgment. Corinth is not unique in the apostolic ministry of Paul for struggling with divisions. They just seem to have had a more debilitating effect there. He writes, for example, to the church at Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. Now watch this. With all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. For there is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. The church at Philippi, where there was two ladies that had squared off and causing disruption, people lining up behind one or the other. He said in Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 5, so if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, in other words, he says, are you deriving any of that at all from the gospel? In fact, you could, since there is encouragement, since there is comfort, since there's the participation in the Spirit, since there's affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others, having this mind in you among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. And he goes on, of course, and he talks about what we call that powerful passage, the kenosis passage. The word kenosis, we've told you before, comes from the Greek word for emptying, because Jesus emptied himself of these divine prerogatives and privileges and prestige and position and comes to earth. He goes on and talks about that in Philippians 2. He humbles himself. He takes upon himself the form of a servant. He humbles himself so much that he's found obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And then as Paul is telling about this, in verse 14 and 15 of Philippians 2, do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God, without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. This call to agree Now, Paul is not advocating here uniformity. He's not pushing for a lockstep group think where someone takes over your mind and thinks for you. Years and years ago when I pastored in another state, looked up one morning and there was about 30 or 40 people from a church in the area that I knew the church, knew the pastor. They'd come, and of course, as I do in those situations, I met with them afterwards and said, why are you here? Because I don't fish other people's tanks. I don't capitalize on other people's pastor's troubles, as some folks do. And I began to talk to their leaders. And it turns out that the fellow that was a pastor had been sort of occultic. And one of the guys said, he said, for X years I have given my mind over to another man and let him tell me how to think. And I said, we're not talking about that. That's when I say cultic, there was a personality cult. The guy just, I remember talking to some of the folks and I'd say, well, what about this? And they would say, well, Brother So-and-so says, So finally I asked one of them, I said, well, what does the scripture say? Because if what he says lines up with the scripture, good. But if you can't trace it back to the scripture, then so what? Paul's not advocating a groupthink, cult-like uniformity. What he is advocating is a common mind about the things that matter. In fact, as we get down in 1 Corinthians, you're going to find him dealing with what they call the adiaphora, the things that are not essential, and how you give leeway and bless one another, give some wiggle room to work in those things that are the non-essentials. You know, in the Reformation, they said, in things essential, unity. In things non-essential, liberty. And in all things, charity or love. Well, that's a principle that comes out of the scriptures. So Paul is here talking about that which is essential, that you don't push things that are non-essential to the level of essential and then make it a test of fellowship. And as we get through this passage, you're going to see that for Paul, it was the gospel. He's concerned about the gospel. He's concerned about the message that Jesus Christ came to this earth, lived a sinless life as the eternal Son of God, fully human, came in the fullness of time appointed by God, humbled himself, offered himself to the cruel legal process of the Romans to be beaten beyond recognition, nailed to a cross. And as despicable as all of that was simply the visible backdrop for what was going on when he hung on that tree and he endured God's wrath. He satisfied divine justice by his suffering and death on that cross as he became sin for us, even though he knew no sin, and God emptied his wrath upon his Son rather than emptying his wrath upon those for whom Jesus would die. And Jesus rose from the grave 3 days later and ascended on high in the presence of many witnesses as an infallible testimony that he had died and been raised again. And that is good news to sinners, to know that God has sent his Son to be the Savior of sinners. That's what Paul's concerned about. It's the gospel. And you don't elevate anything above the gospel. It's in the gospel that we can find common agreement. I've said this before. I think I said it introducing this letter. I've said it in other studies we've gone through. It doesn't matter what your background is. Finally, it doesn't even matter what your political affiliation is. It doesn't matter what your ethnic background is. By the way, I got my DNA back this week. So I'll tell you about the story some other time. But I'm not who I thought I was. But that doesn't matter. You see? My experience of grace, my having been saved by grace through faith, and your having been saved by grace through faith gives us a common connection that supersedes any difference we might have. That's what Paul's arguing for here when he says, all of you agree that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united In the same mind, Philippians 2, that mind which was also in Christ Jesus, that humility that attends the gospel, that not thinking that I'm better than you, or that my thoughts are more important than yours, or that my way is better than your way, or that my preference ought to get the primary attention. Those things are all contrary to humility. If I insist on my way or you insist on your way, then it's probably a good sign that we may have missed God's way. That's what he's arguing for here. Be united in the same mind and the same judgment. In other words, measuring the things by the right standard. Jesus said in the gospel, stop judging by outward appearances and make a righteous judgment. He said in Matthew 7, verses 1 and following, it's a verse that's been twisted by people to dodge God's righteous requirements of people who've been saved by grace through faith. But it does say there in Matthew 7, judge not lest you be judged, for with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. And he's talking there about use the standard of judgment that is anchored in the Scripture. And Paul's concern here is that they're not doing that. So he makes this appeal to strive. That's one of the words that's used in the New Testament. That's not used in the passage here, but it's a word that's used for striving, which is the word agonizomai. Now, if you've ever worked out strenuously, you have agonizomai. You've agonized. You strain. You see, unity in the body of Christ does not come happenstance. It doesn't just come passively. Why? Because I'm a sinner saved by grace, still battling remaining sin. You're a sinner saved by grace, still battling remaining sin. But if we're not battling remaining sin and determining to put that behind us and put forward Jesus Christ and him crucified and our common relationship to one another through that powerful reality, if we're not striving for that, then I can promise you that one of the laws of thermodynamics is going to be in play, that everything is settling into a state of atrophy. Unity will be atrophied. We live in a fallen world that ensures that. If you want to get an idea of what happens when you're not striving to promote unity in the body of Christ, go to Lowe's or Home Depot or Walmart and buy you a short piece of hose. And you're going to get it, and you're going to, well, it's flexible, it's pliable, man, it's great. And put it out in the yard. Just leave it out in the yard for a while. Now, how do I know that happens? I have 5 children, and growing up, it seems like our hose ended up out in the yard more often than not. Beautifully pliable hose. You could take that thing when you first got it and bind it up and wrap it around. Let it sit out in the yard a while. Go pick it up and try to wrap it up. It's tight. It kinks easily now. It's atrophy. That's what happens to unity in a church, if we're not striving, if we're not intentionally saying, I'm not going to be a person who promotes or supports division in a church. When I hear something that is going that direction, I'm going to remember what the Puritans said. They said the person who spreads gossip and untruth has the devil on his tongue, and the person who receives it has the devil in his ear. I'm not going to let the devil get anywhere into my anatomy. Paul's talking about this here. So it's an appeal he makes. The second thing, that there must be a commitment to Jesus Christ above all other allegiances. Now he gets down to the nitty-gritty of how it's manifesting, just one of the ways it's manifesting itself in the church at Corinth. As I said earlier, it has to do with their preachers. Verses 11 and following. For it's been reported to me by Chloe's people that there's quarreling among you, my brothers. So in other words, rather than blessing, you know, we're working off this Bell's acrostic. We're to bless people. Commit every week to bless at least three people, 2 of whom are members, 1 who is not a member. Now, you don't have to say, well, you know, gosh, I got all my blessing out of the way on Monday. No, you can just be blessing people all week long. But you want to try, that's a good little place to start. You know, to bless people. Well, this is not blessing people when you're fussing about preachers. that you're quarreling among you, my brothers. What I mean is what's been told me is that each one of you, so there's enough of them doing this that it's not a small part. Well, I follow Paul. Paul's my favorite preacher. Well, I follow Apollos. You know, the fellow we used to have? Man, he was articulate. Boy, could he teach the word. I tell you, I got blessed. And that's the guy we got now. He's okay, but he's not Apollos. Some say, well, you know, that's fine if you like Paul and Apollos. But I'll tell you what, Peter's kind of rough. But he's a straight shooter. Peter comes right at you. Don't misunderstand what Peter said. That's what was going on. And then, and we don't know, we really don't know for sure, but it seems the context is that Paul is not applauding that group that was saying, you bunch of preacher worshipers, I follow Jesus. Now, that's where he wants you to get, but apparently not with the attitude that was being manifested here. So they're fussing over who their favorite preacher is. And I've seen that. You know, in my journey, I started out of seminary. God was very merciful to me. I didn't know a thing. And so he stuck me in a church in Shreveport, Louisiana that had 5,000 members with a man, a senior pastor, who was an incredible guy. And I'm just soaking it up like a sponge. And in the fullness of time, when I was there 5+ years serving that capacity, people began, they would come to me and say, well, you know, in fact, I had it happen when I went to the hospital one time. Well, I'm glad to see you because, you know, you're really my pastor. Dr. So-and-so is not my pastor. I said, stop. I am here because Dr. So-and-so sent me. He's your pastor. I serve with him. And I'm privileged to serve with him. People would come and say when I would do some teaching, something, you know, well, we really like your teaching more than I said, stop. Stop. We're just different voices. We're different vessels, different vehicles. Both called by God. And so having experienced that on that end of it, when I went to serve in the first place that I took on the senior pastor role, was there nearly 9 years. When I got ready to leave, I sat down with the leadership and I said, now, whoever God brings in behind me, you will not bless me, you will not flatter me if you start comparing him to me. Now, in God's incredible wisdom, he sent a man in behind me who's one of my best friends in the ministry, whose shoes I cannot shine as a pastor and a teacher and a preacher. So there wasn't any problem with that there. But I made sure when I left to let him know, you don't contact me and tell me, boy, I sure do miss your preaching. Uh-uh, that does not bless me. And here's the deal. In ministry, you really don't know if you built it around yourself or built it around Christ until you leave. So I went to another place. Was there 13 years. Got ready to leave. By that time, many of my kids are grown. And Josh and Jason will tell you, they remember the conversation when I said to them, you support this pastor that comes in. Bless him. Be an encouragement to him. Don't compare him to me. That's not fair. Not fair. I wonder about the integrity of a pastor who will let somebody run down another pastor thinking they're building him up. In fact, Linda will tell you, we were in the office one day and a fellow came in several years ago wanting to take a look around our place. He wanted to check out our Sunday school rooms and stuff. And I said, well, you know, they're kind of square rooms. They've got four walls. They've got chairs in them. I'm thinking about coming here. Well, okay, sure. I'll tell you what, this pastor we got out of it. And I said, stop. Stop. Jesus Christ is not exalted when people play pastor favorites. Paul is concerned about that at Corinth. And I don't know how much longer God has me here, you know. Part of me would love to die here, and there's probably some people who think, well, we hope sooner than later, but you know, that's okay. You know, God knows how to take care of that. But when I'm gone, same thing is true. You'll do me no favors. You don't bless me. Understand God's providence for having his man where he wants him at his time, with the gifts and the graces and the capacities. Apollos was apparently a very articulate man. We're told that when he spoke early in the book of Acts, that a couple took him aside, and he was very eloquent, articulate. They took him out and schooled him more deeply in the word, that he might be more accurate. But apparently very eloquent. Paul was not. I mean, you get these descriptions of Paul he'd been so beaten up and stuff, and he apparently wasn't a very attractive man to begin with. He kind of hunched over, and I get this picture almost of Quasimodo. You know, when he's moving around, he's got eye problems, and he would have an amanuensis write things for him, a secretary who would write down, and then he would get to the end of his letter, and he would sign his own letters. We'll see what big letters I use and sign. Apparently, when he was with folks, didn't strike a very good figure, and people, the false apostles, which go after him in 2 Corinthians, I say, oh yeah, you know, Paul's really mean when he writes his letters, but when he comes in, he's just timid as he can be. He dealt with all that. But he did not want the folks at Corinth to be of a party spirit. Look what he says. Is Christ divided? Do you think Jesus Christ is blessed and exalted when you pick favorite preachers? If you really believe that they're gifts of Jesus, which is what Paul says in Ephesians 4, he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some pastor teachers, some evangelists for the equipping of the saints to do the work of the ministry to build up the body of Christ. He said, do you think is Christ divided? Imagine giving out gifts at Christmas and rather than the setting being where folks are excited about their gift, where they start, well, I like my gift better than yours. I think you got an inferior gift. That totally undermines the spirit and the heart of the giver. Is Christ divided, he asked? Was Paul crucified for you? Why would anybody latch yourself to Paul? Paul says, I'm the chief of sinners. Why in the world? I didn't die on a tree for you. Were you baptized in the name of Paul? In other words, I wasn't starting a movement of my Pauline followers, the Paulicians. And then he does something that pastors try to avoid doing. This is kind of humorous when he says, well, I thank God that I didn't baptize any of you, except Crispus and Gaius. Yeah, and I also baptized the household of Stephanus. Now he's in a little bit of trouble here. And I don't know if I baptize anybody else or not, but he's, you know, when you start, so I always want to thank a few people here today, and you leave somebody out, then you're kind of counterproductive. Well, he's kind of gotten this to me shows some of the authenticity and genuineness of this letter. He's a pastor writing to a church that he started. And his heart's breaking that his labors in the gospel are taking back seat to him. To him. And folks, that's painful, whether it's taking back seat to him because people are extolling him, or taking back seat to him because people are going after him, trying to assassinate him. Either one, when the gospel goes on the back burner, any man who has the heart of a pastor grieves. And Paul is grieving here. He says, I don't know if I baptized anyone else. So Jesus Christ has got to be at the forefront. Now he's going to talk later on here in 1 Corinthians 11. Just look at this real quickly, verses 18 and 19. He says, in the first place, when you come together as a church, talking about the Lord's Supper here, I hear that there are divisions among you. So there's divisions about that, about how they're supposed to handle the Lord's Supper. And I believe it in part. And watch what he says. But there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. He said, you know what divisions do? Not only do they undermine the gospel ministry, Think about this. In divisions, both parties cannot be right. When someone pushes an envelope in a church to cause divisions, it's a risky thing because, you see, that person doing that may be the one that's going to be exposed as wrong. And when someone disrupts the unity of the church and they do so sinfully when they're wrong, then they should be subjects. And we're going to look at corrective discipline in chapter 5. They should be subjects of church discipline. Paul says, I understand that that happens so that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. In other words, sometimes you'll see, I've seen it happen, where people who would put forth themselves as leaders and cite their resume when they are divisive and they simply show themselves to be selfish, immature, not mature people. Paul's giving a warning for that. Because you see, quarrelsomeness or divisions or divisiveness is identified as an act of the sinful nature. Look at Galatians 5, 19 to 21. Remember Galatians 5, we went through Galatians together. Verses 19 to 21 is the works of the flesh, contrasted in verses 22 following with the fruit of the Spirit. Notice what it says. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity. There's the enmity, you see, that quarrelsome spirit. Strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries. I follow Apollos. Dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things. Now, notice something. Just think of these horrible, despicable sins as a parenthesis. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery. Okay, look at the other parenthesis. Envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. And in the middle of these two parentheses of horrible, scandalous sins is enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, and divisions, right in the heart of these works of the flesh. And he says, and I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things, in other words, if that's the practice of someone, if that's the way that they roll, or this woman said to me one time, well, that's just the way I am. And I said, well, if that's just the way you are, then you are lost. That those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. He doesn't say that those who do such things will get just a small little green grass shack in it. No, will not inherit the kingdom of God. So this is serious stuff. Now I'm going to just read to you quickly 1 Corinthians 3:1-4. This is where we're headed with this, because when he talks about some other things, he's not through with this in his mind. Look, but I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. And even now you are not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way? For when one says, I follow Paul, another, I follow Apollos, are you not being merely human? So he's still got this on his mind all the way into chapter 3. This idea of divisions. You see, divisions and quarreling in the church hinder or undermine the effective proclamation of the gospel. We'll show you why. Richard Baxter, who was one of the Puritans, said this. The public takes notice of all this. Talking about now, in the 17th century, he's talking about divisions in the church. This is not a new thing. The public takes notice of all this and not only derides us, but becomes hardened against all religion. When we try to persuade them, they see so many factions that they do not know which to join. And they think it better not to join any of them. Thus, thousands grow in contempt of all religion by our divisions. And by the way, when the Puritans use religion, they're talking about the real thing, the gospel. Paul asked, was I crucified for you? No. 1 Corinthians 15:3, he says, I delivered, this is toward the end of the same letter now, I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. That is the most important thing, the gospel. Well, We need to move on. Number three, there must be a commitment to the proclamation of the gospel. He says in verse 17, for Christ did not send me to baptize. Now, he's already talked. He says, I thank God I didn't baptize any of you, except a few of you I did baptize. But because it's you weren't baptized in Paul's name. I've seen people, you've seen people do this, haven't you? Well, brother so-and-so baptized me, and that's all there. So anything beyond that. I've had people say to me, and you've probably heard this, but my children were baptized in that baptistry. When I first got to the church in an old historic town in Louisiana, the building there was 150-something years old. I mean, it was 100 years old. It had been bombed in the Civil War and had to be rebuilt. First thing, my first couple Sundays there, you're not going to tear down this building, are you? My kids were baptized. I said, I didn't come here to tear down a building, if that's what you're asking, but if the need arises, the people that built this 100 years ago didn't build it as a shrine. They built it as a place where the people of God could gather, and when that no longer works, I'm sure that they would be fine. Well, let's do it. Well, you better not do that, because my children were baptized in that bath. So what? You have completely missed Paul here when you get absorbed in those kinds of things. Thank God there was a roof over your head for that to happen. You didn't have to do it down the creek. I baptized people in creeks before. It's interesting. Particularly if you step too far back with your waders on. It's interesting, believe me. I thank God for a level piece of water that I kind of know where I'm going when I'm up there. But I'm not going to worship that. Christ didn't send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. And not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. He said, I never preach the gospel trying to impress people with what I know or how I could say it or what kind of phrase I could spend. Because you see, when it comes to become about him and his delivery and his style, then the gospel, he says, is rendered ineffective. It's emptied of its power because it's no longer about Christ. It's no longer about him crucified. It's no longer about the Spirit taking that when it's proclaimed by frail, imperfect vessels and using that to powerfully transform people's lives. When it becomes about the preacher, when you make it about the preacher. Look at Ephesians. See, the gospel is a message of the powerful bringing together, reconciling of that which was not reconciled previously. Look at this passage here. This is after that great passage, by grace you're saved through faith, that not of yourselves is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before prepared that we should walk in them. Then he says this, therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh called the uncircumcision by what's called the circumcision, the Jews, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope without God in the world. That's what you were, Gentiles. That's what I was. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one, distant Gentile, privileged Jew. Made both one, and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, those ceremonial laws we've been looking at on Sunday nights. By abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that kept the Jews hemmed in and kept the Gentiles out. He said he tore that down that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two. No longer Gentile, no longer Jew, Christ follower. So making peace, peace with God, peace with one another. And might reconcile us both to God in one body. Get to Ephesians 4, he's going to hammer, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one. Into one body, through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. You see, a cross that doesn't kill the hostility is an empty, impotent cross. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, Gentiles, and peace to you who were near, Jews. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but your fellow citizens with the saints, members of the household of God, your family, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, joined together, grows into a holy temple of the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place by God and the Spirit. Oneness, 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 unity, unity, no division. You see, the cross is rendered of its power. I mean, you can't finally keep people from being saved by being obnoxious as a professing Christian. But boy, you can cut the nerve of the witness of the cross. When you appeal to people, I implore you in Christ's name, be reconciled to God. And the first thing is, aren't you part of that church where they fuss and fight, where they've split so many times, they've started so many churches in the area? Not because of a missionary compulsion, but because they can't get along with one another. Be reconciled to God. You render the witness and the power of the cross ineffectual when you participate in, when you promote, when you allow disunity. When you let anything appear to be as important as the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, then somebody in the household of Chloe is going to tell on you. And it won't be pretty. Paul's got some issues with these people. And that's why I tell you, we're going to study this and pray. Dear God, we have a history of that. Let's don't deny that. It's not a distant history. It's a history. But look at this and say, dear God, if I've ever had a part in that, wash my hands clean. Wash my heart clean. I don't want to ever be a part of that. Because I don't want it to be said of me, that person's talk, that person's actions rendered the cross empty, void, null of its power. Oh, Father, let me glory in the cross. May all my glory be in the cross. Let me humble myself. Let me die to self and promote Jesus Christ and rally around the cross and recognize that if I've been bought by the blood of Christ and he or she has been bought by the blood of Christ, that blood has brought us together, made of us one new person. Christians. That's what he's talking about here. My prayer is that I will not, number one, promote disunity. And if you want to come to me and say, well, Pastor, I want to tell you about something that happened, I will look at you and I will repent to you in the presence of God. Say, dear God, forgive me. Nor do I, as the watchman on the wall, want to allow disunity. And I don't want you to get drawn into that, because it's very easy to get drawn into it. No, I want the cross of Jesus Christ to be powerful, pregnantly powerful in this place, in your life and witness, in our study classes, in our times of worship, in our times of fellowship, in your goings and comings, as you go out to bless people, as you sit down to table fellowship, that you won't have to defend this church. Oh, people say, oh yeah, Bethel, wow, I've heard about the love that y'all have. I've heard about the compassion you have. That you're meditating before the Spirit, listening to Him will not be hindered because you have bloody hands from participating in or allowing disunity. As you learn more of Christ, that there won't be this walking contradiction where I'm learning to be more like the humble Savior who humbled Himself, and yet I find myself being pridefully insistent on my way or the highway. And so when I live as a sent one, it'll be obvious to those I encounter that I've been with Jesus, and what they tell me about their walk with Him, and what they tell me about the place where they grow in grace together is appealing, attractive, magnetic. Paul's concerned about the glory of God in Christ. He's concerned about the witness of the Corinthian church in a very pagan society. We must be concerned about the glory of Christ. We must be concerned about the witness of Bethel Church in an increasingly pagan society. Let's pray. Dear Holy Father, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we bow before you in Jesus' name. Lord, we don't want to have the reputation of the Corinthian church. We ask cleansing, forgiveness, renewal, strength, a fresh commitment to unity in the gospel, and recognizing that the unity we have in Christ is greater than any difference we might have otherwise. We're thankful for the unifying effect that the gospel tears down walls between black and white and red and yellow and Jew and Gentile and upper crust and down and out, and Republican and Democrat and independent and on and on and on, that the cross makes the difference. Oh God, help us to glory in the cross. Rally around the banner of the cross and let nothing and no one hinder us from that. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.